seconds to the pre-roll.
Welcome to another of our Wednesday yachting luncheons. We look out the windows. We almost always get the beautiful sun, but it's beautiful anyway. Looking at it, incredible rain. We love this rain. We were waiting for it for months, and we finally got some. We get sound effects, rain, everything. Our sound guy, man, Bobby, really cool. So it gives me great pleasure to introduce the Commodore, the historic first female Commodore of the St. Francis Yacht Club, Teresa Brandner, Commodore Brandner.
Thank you, Ron. And yes, it is raining. We are so blessed to have rain. I know that with the fires up in Butte County, we really were hoping for rain, and now we have it. We're not used to it, though, so it's a little shocking. But we love it all. And well, welcome, everyone, members and guests in the room, and those of you who are tuning in online. Welcome to our Wednesday Yachting Luncheon. And thankfully, this year we've been streaming it live, so that's great that you can watch online, even if you can't make it here. And so, Ron, you always have such great speakers. Thank you for that. You've put on a great year. And I've come to just about all of them, I think. Been good. It's been really fun. And I'm actually learning a few things. So that's terrific. And today's speaker, equally as interesting, if not more so than what we've seen. And I'm looking forward to that, to hearing the presentation today. So welcome, everybody, and look forward to hearing the presentation. Thanks.
Thank you, Commodore.
Thank you, Commodore. So we have an incredible array of speakers coming up. You've been reading about, hearing about, and imagining maybe these gigantic windmills that are taller than the Golden Gate Bridge. Remember I said that? Because one of the inventors, and a distinguished professor he is, with, of all the names, Ron Young, spelled Y-E-U-N-G. He's a PhD with all kinds of credentials. Anyway, he will be here to talk to us about these incredible, giant, floating windmills. There's a few of them built thus far, three, I think. They're in Europe right now, but we're going to get to hear about those. He'll be here in March. In February, we're going to hear about a history of yachting in the California Delta. Not just because, and thank you to the PICYA for naming me Yachting Historian of the Year, but because we're all got a hankering to find out what about a history of yachting in the California Delta. So we have an ideal speaker to come and talk to us all about it. Many of us grew up sailing up there as young kids, preteens and so on, but people were using the Delta for yachting purposes literally 100 years ago. So we're going to get a great talk on that subject. We'll have a four-star general come and talk to us a little bit about the view of retired military on the scene in the world right now. So national security as seen through the eyes of a retired four-star general. He'll be here on February 27th. And we all hear about and benefit from the St. Francis Sailing Foundation. So Bill Chrysler, the president, will come and speak to us in January. Our own vice commodore, Paul Heineken, will give us a year in preview, 2019. He'll be speaking in January. And the San Francisco Sailing Science Center, founder, will come and talk to us in early January. And on January 9th, you want to come to hear a history of Tinsley Island itself by people who were there. The Tinsley founding families, Ed Bravelli, Buzz Cox, Barbara Gilmore, Joe Peatman, and Judy Wall will be a panel. You can ask all those questions about how did we come to own Tinsley Island? How much did it cost? How did it get transferred to the club? How did we get the lighthouse up there and so on? And in the end of the year, we'll have the traditional father-son luncheon. That'll be fun with the knot-tying contest. Who's going to win the knot? You guys can all get a shot at the knot-tying contest. A 13-year-old kid won last year, so I want you to come back, you know, with lots of practice behind you. And Gary Jobson will be here on December the 12th. And on December the 5th, Christine Nelson will be here to talk to us about her book on the Treasure Island. And next week, we'll have Mikhail Venikoff. He is a retired ranger, that is to say, military ranger, who's created a business out of helping other retired military find fun, solace, and camaraderie in the post-military world. It's a very, very powerful program. They jump out of airplanes, off bridges, and they like to get back to that exciting moment, and they try not to do anything that is not exemplary. So it's quite an amazing foundation he's created, and he'll be here to talk about it. A little bit about our speaker today. When he was 7, he remembers his first real boating trip being on his grandfather's 43-foot motor sailor. We'll still call that sailing. And it's luxurious. Those of us who sailed in Denny Jordan's Lady remember that even great sailors eventually go to motor sailors. And then they'll take the really big jump that our esteemed member, Peter Noonan, who's here, can tell you, because he did switch over to powerboat and appropriately named his boat the Dark Side. So let's see. At age 19, our speaker today took 9 months off of college. He'd already gotten enough of the sailing bug. So we got on a brigantine, 144-footer, starting in Seattle, down the coast through the Panama Canal, all the way over to Puerto Rico before he got off. That stung him well enough so that later on in the 2000, he did a bareboat charter in the islands of Greece. And so always has kept his hand kind of in the nautical world. But he also was becoming a writer. After getting his BS in biology from Cal Poly, San Luis Obispo, he then got a master's from BU in journalism, in science journalism, wrote an important article on genetic fingerprinting that local Boston area papers picked up back in 88, then went to work for McGraw-Hill and CMP, important business publications, and in 1999 went to Red Herring and was there through the incredible soar and crash that you saw in the 99 to 2003 period. During that time, Holy Cow, a company I founded, he named Red Herring named number one company. It's amazing, amazing to think about how yipes soared. Anyway, he then decided to write books, and he wrote one on the Pan-Pacific Exposition. Our neighbor, the Palace of Fine Arts, is the result of that. We get to have it after the exposition is closed. And then he wrote a book on what everybody wants to know all about, Misfits, Merchants, and Mayhem. And when I read that title, I thought, he's calling somebody, calling a lot of us. But in fact, he's talking about the California waterfront. And it's an incredibly fun, entertaining book. And you're going to want to buy a copy because they're sitting right over there. So afterwards, when you come and get a few words with the speaker, you can also leave with a copy of his book. So with that, let's welcome Lee Bruno. Lee.
Thank you, Ron. Anyway, it's great to be here at the St. Francis Yacht Club. One little footnote is now most of the time I end up swimming past you guys with the South End Rowing Club. So, anyway, but I'm always open for anyone who needs a crew member. So, here we go. So when I wrote my first book, Panorama, I wanted to understand my great-grandfather, R.B. Hale's, role as visionary and director of the Pan-Pacific International Exposition of 1915. Learning the stories of San Franciscans who, for more than a decade of twists and turns and heartbreaks, pursued a dream with remarkable drive and resilience. It opened up a world of stories and historical events that surprised me with its diverse cast of oddball characters, ranging from ingenious inventors to mischievous artists to corrupt politicians, all resolute in establishing San Francisco as one of the great cities of the world. I was hooked. Those quirky, endearing characters set me on a journey to discover more. This illustration, which I'm sure a lot of other San Franciscans and others have seen before, depicts the 1844 waterfront. Our sleepy port was home to about 1,000 inhabitants before the gold rush hit. In those years, about 11 ships before the gold rush dropped anchor in San Francisco Bay, consisting of about 9 whalers and 2 merchant ships in a period of a year or two. A dozen houses or so spread across, where we have Spanish, Mexican ranchers and East Coast merchant vessels doing trade. After gold was discovered, we understand from our history books that things sort of boomed here. In a matter of a couple years, we had 650 American foreign vessels arriving here, carrying more than 90,000 passengers. Many abandoned their ships in the mudflats of San Francisco's shores, where several remain entombed today. Gambling saloons, hotels, and restaurants offered a place for men to socialize. They passed their hours drinking, playing billiards, and gambling. Nearly all of the saloons and gambling houses employed prostitutes who drank with the men and sat at the card tables to attract other players. But a woman walking along the streets of San Francisco was reportedly more of an oddity than an elephant or a giraffe. The town's wide-open living conditions created a wild atmosphere that lacked the moral and social restraints men were accustomed to in their hometowns. Oops. This is just basically just a show, the 28 stories in my table of contents. A lot of stories about men and crazy, mischievous men and merchants, but about 6 of the stories are about women as well, and some remarkable women that are, of course, interlaced with a lot of these stories. So let's go to the next slide here. So, of course, more than 150 years ago, we recognize this character as becoming one of our most endearing misfits. The man was well-dressed and had a serious look on his face when he walked into the office of the San Francisco Bulletin newspaper editor, George Fitch. He handed Fitch an unusual letter which had all the makings of a good story to lighten the mood, because most San Franciscans were mourning the death of popular abolitionist Senator David Broderick, who'd been killed in a duel at Lake Merced by pro-slavery former Chief Justice David Terry. The editors printed the proclamation in the paper under the heading, "Have We an Emperor Among Us?" In his proclamation, Norton urges San Franciscans to assemble in the music hall of this city to make alterations in the existing laws of the Union to ameliorate the evils under which the country is laboring. Norton was a successful businessman who went bankrupt and disappeared from San Francisco for 3 years, then returned to become its mascot, showing up at restaurants and other venues. The emperor made it his business to go about town inspecting San Francisco's streets and monitoring the behavior of the police. A natural orator gave speeches to bystanders about the problems of the city, and popular legend says he held at bay a vicious anti-Chinese mob by reciting the Lord's Prayer. As emperor, he sent orders to Abraham Lincoln, Mexican President Porfirio Diaz, Tsar Alexander of Russia, Queen Isabella of Spain, and other rulers. He was an adversary of corruption and fraud of all kinds, political, corporate, and personal. He was a persistent voice for fair treatment and enhanced legal protections for immigrants and racial and ethnic minorities. He demanded that African Americans be allowed to ride public streetcars and that he be admitted to public schools. He commanded that the courts allow Chinese people to testify in court, and he pronounced that the eyes of the emperor will be upon anyone who shall counsel any outrage or wrong on the Chinese. He proclaimed, with respect to Native Americans, that all Indian agents and other parties connected with fraud against the Indian tribes were to be publicly punished before as many Indian chiefs as would be assembled together. Some 21 years later, in 1880, Emperor Norton collapsed from a heart attack walking up California near Grant. His only possessions were a gold and silver piece and an 1828 franc. His fans gave him an elaborate funeral fitting for an emperor attended by 30,000 loyal subjects. Norton shared the same streets with Henry Meigs, who walked these in 1850s. Meigs noticed Honest Harry, who some of you in the audience probably have read about, a swashbuckling capitalist who built the biggest sawmills on the West Coast and by the age of 26 had amassed a fortune as a Manhattan lumber dealer before the panic of 1937 put his company out of business. The irrepressible Meigs rebounded, then headed for San Francisco with a ship loaded with lumber to supply the gold rush with the much-needed timber to rebuild after the many fires it had. He rolled his mighty profits, 20x of what he spent, into the two sawmills and began building piers in the city, becoming the largest landowner in the area. He amassed $500,000 in gold, or $15 million in today's currency. But by 1854, the markets had sort of caught up, and real estate prices plunged with rampant speculation, forcing him into bankruptcy, which he managed to keep secret through a Ponzi scheme. As city councilman, he embezzled $1 million, $29 million today, which wiped out hundreds of unwitting investors, most of the city's bank reserves. He finally realized the gig was up, and fearing for his life, he crept out at night on a schooner with his family, but in pursuit was a mob of investors. And the story goes is that as he was becalmed close to the Farallon Islands, and the steamboat was coming up to catch up to him and to lynch him, and one of the steamboat's paddles was sort of, broken. It wasn't quite making way as it should. And all of a sudden, the wind comes up, and then off goes Meigs to Chile. So that's a nice escape. So he began building railroads in Chile and Peru, and he made millions and eventually paid back every cent he owed to investors in the city of San Francisco. He died in 1877 in Lima, Peru, while constructing a railroad in Costa Rica. William Shorey, who posed here in Oakland, California in the late 1880s, family portrait with his wife and children, who he took on whaling voyages. Other misfits who arrived here, he was called the Black Ahab and established himself as the only African-American ship captain and large ship owner on the Pacific coast a few years after the Civil War had ended. Born in 1859 to a Scottish father and a Creole mother, he grew up on the West Indian island of Barbados. He became a cabin boy on a ship bound for Boston. And several years after arriving in San Francisco in 1878, where he captained a successful whaling voyage to the Arctic and Pacific for more than 30 years, but despite mishaps and near mutiny, when his white crewmen set fire to his ship, he persevered. He ended up retiring and working as a night watchman, I think, on the Oakland shores. And there were merchants with a penchant for eccentric tendency like the Crowley brothers. Here, this picture showing Tim and Dave Crowley as they converse at Howard Street Wharf in San Francisco around 1905. As a child, Thomas Crowley fell in love with Whitehall boats known as the Bicycles of the Seas, used to ferry goods, services, and sailors on and off the boats coming into New York Harbor, named after Whitehall Street in New York. In 1892, at the age of 17, Crowley purchased an 18-foot Whitehall for $80 and began a water taxi service delivering supplies, passengers, and crew members to and from ships anchored in San Francisco Bay. Armed with an unrelenting drive and mischievous sense of humor, the Crowley brothers realized in 1897 that they needed to upgrade their rowboats to gasoline-powered boats to reach vessels faster. By the early 1900s, the Crowley brothers had established a strong water taxi service for ship owners and merchants. 6 million tons of goods from around the world passed through San Francisco at the time, making San Francisco's port the international trading center of America's West Coast. The brothers continued to grow and expand over the next several decades to keep pace with the boom in the global shipping and demands, and both the Red and White Ferry Service and Crowley Maritime that sprang from these two brothers' visions survive and thrive today. So here's a brief excerpt from the book, which is will definitely convince you of their mischievous behavior. Crowley's competitive nature got his water launch service in trouble with the authorities on August 21st, 1904. As he was operating the guide, he got too close to the Emily Whitney while the vessel was still under federal quarantine orders to protect against the spread of diseases, according to the San Francisco Call. Surgeon Cumming, head of the quarantine service, gave chase in the motor launch vessel named General Sternberg. Quote, no shots were fired across the launch's bow, but a capture was effected. Crowley was brought aboard the quarantine steamer along with his crew. They were taken to Angel Hour, where the powers that administer the quarantine laws had a heart-to-heart talk with the water taxi crew. Crowley pleaded with the authorities that his proximity to the Whitney was due to a temporary derangement of the optic nerves, which prevented him seeing the yellow flag. He promised to abide by the quarantine laws in the future. His promise was noticed, but before restoring his freedom, the doctors gave Crowley what in the quarantine circles is known as the 97th degree. In the words of the Call reporter, they took away his clothes, boiled them in disinfectants, then dried them in a fume-filled oven. In the meantime, the two attendants gave Crowley an anti-plague bath, as they did other crew members. When he left the island, his shoes, which had been boiled and roasted with the rest of his wearing apparel, pinched sadly, and the fashionably blue-cut suit in which he had stepped ashore was a sad, purple-colored thing that clung closely to form and limb. Crowley's brown necktie had turned pink from the washing, and his watch stopped at 11:15 o'clock. On leaving the quarantine station wharf, Crowley said farewell to Surgeon Cumming and said, I'll remember, doctor. Liu Hing. Like other merchants, he faced challenging obstacles in his business career that began in 1871 when he sailed from China to San Francisco, and within 6 years, he pioneered commercial scale food canning and established the Pacific Coast Canning Company. He'd use his creative ingenuity to drive his experiments in canning to figure out how to safely can foods at a large scale. The Chinese faced discrimination at the time, especially after the economic downturn in the 1870s. In 1882, the Chinese Exclusion Act stopped Chinese immigration and prevented Chinese already in the country from owning real estate. Hing's unrelenting drive and shrewd business instincts helped him weather not just discrimination, but legal run-ins when the authorities seized 516 cans of illicit opium that bore the label of his company. He was eventually cleared of the charge, and in 1906, after the great earthquake and fire destroyed his home, Hing helped victims, opening his cannery to the homeless and feeding them. He expanded his businesses to include fruit orchards, a hotel, import and export companies, and became president of the Canton Bank of San Francisco. Despite discrimination, Hing's reputation as a respected businessman and community leader increased. He died in 1934 with scarcely a mention of his passing in the local newspapers. Irving Scott. In 1865, Peter Donahue, a failed gold prospector and iron foundry pioneer, sold his ironworks, Union Ironworks, to his apprentice, Irving Murray Scott, a 28-year-old with a sharp mind and aptitude for things mechanical. After he bought the ironworks, Scott designed and built most of the machinery used to mine the silver of the Comstock Lode in Nevada. He went on to make a fortune by manufacturing and selling equipment to mine owners and railroad companies. He was also a Mechanics Institute member, and in 1880, he had traveled the year with a San Francisco businessman named James Fair and studied the shipyards of England and came back and then started the focus on building ships, and the Union Iron Works was known around the world for its amazing shipbuilding prowess and really outdistancing East Coast competitors. This face is probably very familiar to everybody. Jack London, born in Oakland. He worked as a street newsboy in the age of 10. He was out and about on his sloop, Razzle Dazzle, and was basically an oyster pirate over on the flats over Alameda. And he, there was a short story that was he wrote about being oyster pirates. But anyway, his venture into criminality kind of was switched around when they decided he was too good of a sailor to be raiding the oyster beds, and instead became part of the fish patrol. We all know these famous photographs of the Great Earthquake and Fire. This is Arnold Genthy, who I write about in the book. The view down Sacramento Street, right near Powell, on the morning of the Great Fire. Here's the burn area with these illustrations. Are quite amazing that were done after the fire, just to show the devastation. And with that great destruction of 300,000 out of, I think, San Francisco's 410,000 residents were left homeless, fleeing to other counties and cities and even countries. But the rebuild was clearly on the minds of San Franciscans. And one of the people that was principally a mover and shaker in that time was Julia Morgan, who became California's first female architect with quite a notable career, and had been schooled by architect Bernard Maybach at UC Berkeley. And her career is fascinating in terms of just her getting into the L'Ecole. She did not speak French. She went over and with grit, determination, and clear vision, she became one of our greatest architects for California and probably of the world too. And so, with the rebuilding, the fast rebuilding of the city by 1908, some of the principal strong business community here. Including those that were principally involved in the Pan Pacific Exposition, convinced the Great White Fleet to come to our shores. So in 1908, some of the largest crowds ever assembled, somewhere around 500,000 were on the, I mean, if you see some of the photos, you not here, but they're just specks of just people all over the coastline watching this Great Fleet come in during Teddy Roosevelt's reign. And there was then the fishing industry, and Achille Palladini, who pioneered fishing industry at the turn of the 20th century. This is a picture on Saturdays when these fishermen would mend their nets in the port. This is about 1905. And Palladini arrived in San Francisco from Italy in 1865 on a merchant ship and encountered a picturesque city and a thriving Italian community. He learned there was money to be made as a fisherman, as Italians dominated the fishing industry with a bay abundant with Dungeness crab, oysters, salmon, and striped bass. He looked hard and applied his creative and cunning skills to the business, investing in his own boats and real estate. He loved opera and was living the high life until the 1906 quake destroyed all of his uninsured properties and left him broke. Fishermen would typically leave with enough provisions on these boats that were these, you can see in the picture, the spars from these lateen-rigged feluccas. For 3 or 4 days with very little in their possession of in the way of food. But by 1910, Palladini had grown his company into a formidable powerhouse and came under the scrutiny of the California antitrust regulators for its monopolistic market practices. Despite the challenging setback, Palladini grew his operation over the next decade into the West Coast's largest wholesale seafood distributor. He died in 1921 at the age of 78. And of course, stories of mayhem. The mugshot detective Isaiah Lees, who was born in Scotland and came to San Francisco shore as an iron worker. After witnessing a murder, he brought the perpetrator to justice and decided to become a police officer in 1853 when lawlessness was a part of everyday life. This curious Lees studied the autobiography of a man named, he studied the work of François Vidocq, the world's first private detective from Paris who pioneered the use of disguises, informants, detailed criminal records, and meticulous record keeping. Lees applied Vidocq's methods and also realized criminals' photographs could be helpful in detective work. He enlisted a newly arrived photographer from Hong Kong to take criminal portraits, and he amassed 15,000 photographs and criminal records of for San Francisco, and today he's honored in Scotland Yard with it, where his portrait still hangs. And jazz emerged from the brothels of New Orleans and spread to similar establishments in San Francisco, which developed a strong and thriving jazz scene. zoning regulations allowed for dance hall, nightclubs, and brothels in city-designated vice districts, which in San Francisco were the Barbary Coast and North Beach, roughly Pacific, Montgomery, and Stockton. Those are sort of some rough sort of coordinates for it. A few small black-owned jazz clubs managed to regain a foothold in the Barbary Coast, including the Neptune, the Palace, the Elko, and the Olympia, which sold near beer and featured dancing girls. Several new dances that became nationwide crazes, such as the Texas Tommy Swing that dominated at Lou Purcell's Cabaret and other Pacific Avenue clubs in 1911. And of course, the great waterfront strike of 1934. San Francisco's port was booming with work and maritime commerce in the 1930s during the Great Depression, but was marked by violent conflict between the longshoremen and shipping owners. On July 3rd, 1934, those tensions led to a strike that paralyzed our port and led to utter mayhem. Longshoremen walked out on their jobs demanding reforms in hiring practices and pay. Owners, desperate as their losses mounted, recruited and provided police protection to strikebreakers in the ports determined to crush the strike. The longshoremen stood their ground, and Alfred Bridges, better known as Harriet Bridges, was the chief spokesman for the union in negotiations. Like other longshoremen, he was forced to work grueling hours, grueling shifts at an unrelenting pace that was unsafe and led to two injuries. He was a consummate and unrelenting organizer. He visited black churches and asked congregations to join the strikers, promised that blacks would be able to work the West Coast docks when the strike was over, and he kept his promise on that. Eventually, the thousands of striking longshoremen prevailed after 4 weeks of strikes, the city barely surviving the killing of two strikers, hundreds of bloody skirmishes, citywide labor walkouts, and owners suffering big losses from undelivered spoiled goods stranded on the dock. In the aftermath, Bridge, as I said, kept his promise, and he served as the president of the International Longshoremen and Warehouses Union in it for 40 years and died in 1990 at the age of 88. And that concludes my talk. So thank you very much.
Welcome again to the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon from the St. Francis Yacht Club. Our speaker today, Lee Bruno, is a really thoughtful, great writer and chronicler of San Francisco's mid-century history. So tell us, what's a day in the life of somebody who's going to write a history of San Francisco like? Where would you get information? Where were your research sources? Yeah. Give us some. You wake up in the morning, what do you do first?
Oh, I have coffee always. Well, it's kind of interesting. I mean, it's my entry into this. It's just to back up a little bit. Is just that my great grandfather was the director, and he was the visionary for the Pan Pacific Exposition. So originally, the very first essay that I wrote was about him, and he was like, he was at the Merchants Exchange. He was the president. He made this presentation. He says, "We should have a fair here." Great, you know, that's 1904, just before the Panama Canal. So I went back to that story and started studying it, looking at speeches, and accidentally just tripped over more and more material.
But so he was an architect?
No, he was a businessman. The Hale Brothers Stores was, he ran it with his brothers, and they were downtown San Francisco.
Yeah, they were around to the 50s, Hale Brothers
Stores. Yes, right. And then after a series of mergers, they were like...
Yeah. There was a big roll-up in retail.
Exactly.
Federated ultimately bought them.
Yeah, you did your homework where you know your merchant history. Good job. So anyway, just to get back to the sources... San Francisco Public Library online history access to the Chronicle that runs back the call to 1850. All this stuff has been digitized. It's pretty amazing what you can find in old newspapers. So that became the beginning of finding this, and that was on microfiche before a lot of it became digitalized. And then the Bancroft. The Bancroft is like one of the great institutions of our Bay Area, and anybody who hasn't been there should go just to see what's there. And then, of course, the California Historical Society, Mechanics Institute. And I think, you know, you just start asking people questions and you know, and other historians, and they helped me kind of find my way. But you're looking for, You're looking for stories. I mean, that's what I was looking for, stories, the people, the characters. What are they doing, and when are they doing it, and why? And trying to fill in the texture. I mean, you know, the books that we, you know, that I read as secondary material was like, you know, I don't know if you ever feel completely comfortable, like feel like you've mastered something. So I don't put myself in that category of a historian, but I do feel like there's, you know, there's been so many wonderful books written about San Francisco and its history that a lot of that sprang out of those readings. So
I'm going to keep asking questions, and if I see anybody raise their hand, they want a question, John will bring the microphone to you, and we'll basically get your questions. John, you have a question.
Yes, I do. Do you think your great-grandfather could create another World's Fair in today's conditions in San Francisco?
Good question, John.
Is there somebody from the city hall here? You know, it's really interesting. There was a historian that was at San Francisco State, and we had that conversation right around the time of Katrina. And he said, you couldn't even see federal agencies working with local government, working with this. So the public-private partnership that was going on was pretty extraordinary. There's a lot of bumps and hiccups and whatnot along the way. So it's possible. I would say it's possible, but it's a lot more improbable due to the complexity and some of the issues. But again, it's like it's driven by a champion. I mean, you have these people that show up in history, women and men that just, they carry a torch and they don't take prisoners. You know, they just go.
So there's lots of stories about men. Tell us an interesting story about a woman from San Francisco early time.
So one of my favorite stories really is about Ina Kobreth. Ina Kobreth, for some people in the audience probably know, she was the first female librarian, and she ran the Oakland Library. She was a poet. She had a pretty extraordinary sort of beginning as a poet, but then her call to responsibility was her sister's daughter, I think it was, that she had to look after. And so she decided not to go with Joaquin Miller to Europe and pursue her poetry, and instead pursued a position as a librarian in Oakland, where, who would be surprised to know, with a woman of her caliber, she would meet Jack London. As a young boy, would come there and check out books. And she gave him reading lists, even though he wasn't supposed to check out books. He was too young when he first shows up. And Jack London writes about his you know, how important she was to him as a young man. She was Bret Hart. All these other writers would come to her, and they would have salons, and she would probably give them feedback on their writing. So Ina Kobreth is like, she's a gem. And there's, you know, several other women in the book, but yeah, I would pick her as one of my favorites.
So what about San Francisco's early history foretold our appetite for innovation and the startup culture that has really started in the last 30 years but has always been around San Francisco?
Yeah, I mean, I think that, like, you can kind of gather that, like, my background is writing about technology and business, and so there's a lot of stuff around the internet and whatnot. But if you just look at, like, Honest Harry showing up, I mean, the guy is just, like, he's irrepressible. I mean, he comes out here, he builds the sawmills, he does the real estate, and he's not done. He goes to Chile and Peru. So I think that there
Levi
is
this,
Strauss. Yes, there's a certain elixir here that I think it was set up by the fact that very little under-resourced, not a lot of established protocols, and so people could really run with their opportunities. And plus, you're talking about a very resource-rich area that had been sort of untapped. All those ingredients, plus, I think, our coast, and, you know, it attracts really, you know, kind of eccentric characters. And so I still believe that, you know, that DNA and that happens here. If you look at the city with how multicultural it was, I mean, I showed William Shorey, I showed some of the other people. It's like, this is a place that is very different than the East Coast. And so, I mean, that keeps coming back as a very strong theme in stuff that I've been writing about in San Francisco.
So, Julia, from the ether, we have a question from the comments on web, online.
We have a lot of people listening, including Michael Schwarzer from Germany and Paul Erickson from Australia.
And from Perth, yet. Yes.
Prince Alfred. Okay. Prince Alfred, yeah.
What time is it there?
9 hours.
Five minus three.
Anyway, but the question is from Alex Kent. What is the history of the Balboa Cafe established in 1913? Do we know?
Good question. Totally got me. No, that's good though, because now I got questions to ask.
Exactly. Tell us a funny story about the waterfront.
Let's see. I think the Crowley story was just interesting from that vantage point of, you know, one of the things I didn't really kind of lay out is like these Whitehall boatmen, they were at a great disadvantage. Well, not a great disadvantage, but, you know, they had to be very crafty. I mean, we all know what it takes to get a sailboat out when the flood is against you, right? So these guys had to really understand when the tides were moving, and when they didn't have an opportunity, they would latch onto the back of a large ship on the way out. So, I mean, there's something to be said about just being resourceful and whatnot to perform these amazing feats of meeting the ships. So one of the stories of Dave Crowley, which was the father of Tom and Dave, an inbound British ship is out 40 miles off of the Farallones, and it's blowing pretty much blowing a gale. And he's looking out, and he spots a guy in a Whitehall boat, and he's like, oh gosh, we got to go rescue him. So he gets the vessel close, comes up to him, and there's Dave Crowley, and he shouts up, you know, he says, are you okay? You know, I'm just making up some of the dialogue here, but the point was they made contact, and Dave Crowley immediately says, do you want some meat and provisions? Okay, now that's either completely nuts, or that just kind of shows you the caliber of, like, you're going out to find inbound ships. So there's a bit of humor and madness in that, but I love that, because I just think that tells us a little bit about what it's here.
So the potato patch, can you tell us how the potato patch got that name? You know about the potato patch?
Yeah, I know the potato patch because I've sailed over it and whatnot, and I've seen it when it's frothing.
Cargo potatoes. So the potatoes kept coming in for a couple more days. That's the potato patch.
That's perfect.
Ran aground there. So you talked about Harry Bridges. So Harry, was the movie on the waterfront about Harry Bridges?
No, I don't think that was the East Coast.
So the second Bridges question, was he a communist?
Well, I think his, so this is where this could be, you know, a really long debate of with the proper people on the stage to talk about it. Here's the thing. It's like he was considered a pinko. He was considered communist. They kept trying to. I think there was an enormous amount of struggle between labor and owners. And Bridges was a really strong, resolute guy. I don't think he was like trying to undermine. Did he do any other actions that actually destroyed? He didn't blow up buildings. I mean, just like, he was just a really, really strong, you know, vantage point of the labor and the worker. So that's the way I look at him in this. And I also look at it just that they're on both sides. I mean, in one of my talks early in this book tour, one of our neighbors came up and said, my uncle was a cop in 1934. And he's during the Great Strike, and he got hit over the head by, you know, a striking laborer. And it's like, people got hurt. I mean, it was just bloody. It was awful. And, you know, there's some bad practices on the police side, and it was just violent. So we survived. Resilient. Again, San Francisco.
So much of the railroads in the California Delta were built with inexpensive Chinese labor. How far back do you see Chinatown starting? What were the early records of Chinatown in San Francisco?
Well, let's see. So the Chinese Historical Society, I mean, I reached out to them, and because Liu Hing's story is really unique and he's really honored by that community, I had a hard time finding a lot of trails of materials. I found a graduate thesis that was about Liu Hing that talked specifically about, and that was, you know, she grabbed things from Chinese newspapers and whatnot. But I think I'm not, you know, I explored some of those dimensions, but I mean, I
so the 1870s,
1860s. Yeah, 1870s, 1860s. There, yeah, and I think that okay. So here's that other funny sort of footnote story that some people know is like it was cheaper to send your laundry to the Sandwich Islands and get it done than to have it done here. So just think, the Sandwich Islands, that's Hawaii. You know, okay. You know, the Chinese came in and at that time, too, became, you know, around that time, they're starting to work in the laundry industry because they it's needed. So I think there's a lot of work to be done to get some of those stories imported into the general dialogue of history so we can capture more of it. And I know there's historians that are doing that now, but I can't vouch to be an expert in that space.
Question from the audience.
Hi.
Yes, hi.
You mentioned Levi Strauss earlier, and I know there are a lot of descendants that are still in the area. Did you speak or meet with any of the descendants when you were writing the book?
So, yeah, the Levi Strauss is a really interesting story. So there was a lot of Misfits and merchant stories that got left on the cutting room floor, and ones that I didn't pursue out of... You know, there was a lot of different sort of inputs, but I didn't pursue Strauss, you know. And some people said, why didn't you write about Sam Brannan? Another really interesting misfit, oddball character. So, yeah, I didn't do a lot of deep work into the in the Strauss, but it's a fantastic long family history. And No, I haven't. No. Not.
I mean generally.
Generally, no, I haven't. Okay, so the question was... Have I met any of the Levi Strauss family descendants?
The Hosses and so on.
The Hosses and whatnot.
Another question in the audience. Bill, Dana.
Bob. Okay. Lee, what do you know about Shanghai Kelly? The bar's been there forever on Polk and Broadway. Love to watch a sports game there, but is there any truth to the rumor of them kidnapping people and they're waking up on ships going to China?
Yeah. So we had a brief discussion about Shanghai. And Shanghai Kelly, you know, there's a lot of small books and whatnot that have written about him. One of the interesting, you know, when I wrote about Tom Crowley, I went back to the UC Berkeley at the Bancroft. They did oral histories. And in 1964, they sat down with him. And I think, I don't know over how much time, but they had an oral history project. So there's a transcript of this interview. It's astonishing because, like, you know, it's really great, you know, and the guy's mind is as sharp as a as ever, and he's in his I think he's in his 80s, but he describes the fact that I mean there's a bit of a mythology around Shanghaiing, and that you know people get hit over the head and then drop through floorboards, and then the Whitehall boat would take them out. Evidently, the state of California, I mean the ports were owned under the state jurisdiction, so you couldn't have a bar on the waterfront. So that you know. Probably happened. Maybe it happened once or twice. It's a good story. But the Whitehall boatmen definitely ferried, you know, people that were clubbed over the head and two vessels that were waiting. And it, a lot of it happened. In fact, you know, it's in that transcript that Tom Crowley talks about that a bit. So, yes, Shanghaiing happened. I'll tell you really, so there's a little footnote story just around that. So what happened in, I get the year wrong, but pretty close to 1880, there was an outbreak of yellow fever. And so the community of the waterfront, which consists of grifters and Shanghaiers and people that are, this is not like your, you know, three-piece suit folks, they decide they're going to raise money. So they decide with the Whitehall boatmen to do a race. And then that race happened every 4th of July for years after. And they raised, like, they raised several, I mean, maybe $340, but in those days, that was a good chunk of money that went to the relief of the families that were afflicted by yellow fever.
So tell us about jazz clubs in early San Francisco.
Well, that's a, I mean, that's
such a... Or in the jazz era.
Yeah, that's so. It's a great, interesting part of San Francisco's history because the perception is that, you know, after the war, we have this absolute flowering of the great jazz that happens here.
After World War I, you're saying?
World War II. World War II, okay. World War II. So that's really when a lot of the narrative of the big jazz names are here. But Jelly Roll Morton, who was playing on the music before we started our lunch, mm-hmm. he owned his own jazz club, and that's 1917 in this Barbary Coast. and there was a couple others that are black-owned clubs. And there's a book that's written, I forget the author's name, but it's The Harlem of the West. It's a wonderful book, and it talks about the jazz and the history of, in San Francisco. It was, you know, again, it's kind of like that William Shorey story. It's like, how does a, you know, an African-American here in San Francisco create that opportunity or make that opportunity happen despite all the, you know, obstacles and challenges that they have? There's other really interesting characters like Mommy Pleasant and whatnot that's been written about. So the jazz, yeah, so these jazz clubs are going on in the Barbary Coast, and it's a pretty wild time, you know? I don't know what else I can add to that.
So on Broadway, just toward the water from Columbus, going down the hill, there used to be something called the International Settlement there. Remember that? And the Navy people after World War II would come up, and that's how essentially the big intersection of Broadway and Columbus was a kind of a night time, was a nightclub area for the Navies. Well, the Barbary Coast was also in that same area. It was just down toward the waterfront. So can you talk a little bit about that district of the Barbary Coast district? It was pretty rowdy. When I was a little, you know, 7-8-year-old kid, my mother didn't want me going near there. Get away. Don't be anywhere. Don't go that area.
Yeah, I think that was the general rule for most kids. Don't wander down there because, like, it was really rough. So with the Shanghaiing, with a lot of the, I mean, that waterfront, when in the early pictures that I showed, you show that early waterfront, and if you notice where Montgomery Street is, it's almost like on the waterfront. So all that fill happens, and of course, there's ships that go ashore, get grounded in mud. All the crew members are gone because they're going to go search for gold and make their fortune. So you have this kind of like very gritty environment that's sort of built very fast over time, and it, of course, you know, prostitution was a big part of the gold rush and all the stories that go along with that. And if you go, I mean, I think the, you know, the other interesting stories at that time is, like, I write about Giuseppe Coppa, who's an Italian restaurateur who comes over. You know, his father wanted him to be a singer. I mean, so his father, he wanted to be a singer. His father wanted him to have a practical, you know, way to make means in his life. And so he had to go in cooking school and came over. He starts this wonderful restaurant, Coppa's, and all of the bohemians end up showing up at his restaurant. And during the day, it's the financial, you know, people of San Francisco that are there. They're eating, and at night, it turns into something a little bit different. And if they can't pay for the food, he says, "Just when you do get your commission for your next thing, then pay me." So you sort of had a little layaway thing on food. I don't think you can do that anywhere here. I know you can't do it here. So, you know, Coppa is another. He's a restaurateur who's in San Francisco, who's in the Barbary Coast. That is really sort of crystallizes, kind of, again, like these thematic things that keep coming back into what is it that's in this strange elixir of, I don't want to be too mystical about it, but San Francisco's, you know, it's unusual, it's unique, and those are the characters that I think really do, you know, illuminate our history.
Another question.
In that, in this era that we're talking about, was there any interaction between City Hall and the waterfront, where City Hall would be fostering or diminishing the prosperity of the waterfront?
Yeah, let's see. I'm trying to think of mayors and whatnot. I mean, I wrote a bit about Sonny Jim Rolfe, who was the mayor at the time of the Pan Pacific Exposition, and he was he was part of the Pacific Steamship. I mean, he had money that was involved in moving ships. He also owned a bordello. So, I think, you know, the corruption and all of that was, I think, if that's where the question is asking, you know, about who owned what and what were the stakes and how involved were they, I think it was a pretty kind of wild mix there. Am I answering that correctly?
There's another way of looking at the public-private partnership.
Yeah, right. Exactly. Maybe that's the public-private partnership we got to go back to, huh? That would really be interesting.
So you've mentioned brothels a couple times. When were they illegal? When was prostitution illegal?
So that's really, again, in the book, I kind of write about this. That's right around 1917, and I write about Reggie Gamble and you know, there's basically a story that that sort of is this minister, and I'm forgetting his name, I'm sorry right now, a reverend who's driving a very strong anti-prostitution and this agenda about cleaning up cities, because the cities had gotten, and this is nationwide, it sort of ends up sort of finishing its rollout here. Gary Camilla wrote about this in Portals of the Past that he writes on the weekends. Anyway, the point is the 300 prostitutes gathered together with the help of Fremont Older, who is the editor of the Bulletin, and they basically kind of like approach the reverend and go into his church and say, you know, how dare you kind of like try to throw us out on the streets? It's like we're trying to make a living. We have no other way to make money at this time. And, you know, I think, you know, it's a really powerful story, again, about the way that groups come together and from all different walks of life. But that is sort of the end of, that's the end of that red light district. The red light, there's a red light abatement act that's done in that same period of time, and it's cleaned up. And then I think it, you know, it sort of creeps back in again. So,
a question from the audience. Yes.
Along the same lines, I was wondering if you looked into the life and times of Sally Stanford at all.
Sally Stanford? No, I'm not. Sorry.
She was an uptown, she had an uptown brothel at the top of the hill up here, and then later moved to Sausalito. And after she moved to Sausalito, my father knew her. After she moved to Sausalito, she then became, what was her official role in Sausalito? She became the mayor of Sausalito. Welcome to the Bay Area.
Yeah.
So talk to us about a colorful mayor. Thank you for the good question. Talk to us about a colorful mayor in San Francisco.
Well, I mean, I like talking about Sonny Jim just because I think he's another, you know, he was such a flamboyant character. In my book Panorama, you know, he is the mayor at the time. And there's a really interesting scene when he's running for office. This just kind of gives you the texture of like what it was like, because you had a very strong sort of union-based town, which is, you know, true. It happened, you know, early on in San Francisco history. And he's running against McCarthy, Pinhead McCarthy. That was his nickname. So he decides to assemble his, you know, give a talk, and I think it's in like Sunnyside. It's a neighborhood. Well, all of a sudden, it's like he arrives there, and there's this mob that just wants to, you know, I mean, I think they want to do physical damage to him. So a kid comes over and whispers into Sonny Jim's ear. He says, "I got a pet bear. Would you like me to bring it down?" So the kid brings the bear down. Everybody dissipates, and Sonny Jim is able to leave the political meeting at that point. I thought it's the color. It's that playfulness. Like, who's got a pet bear? Somebody did in San Francisco.
Novel kind of muscle.
Yeah.
Bring your muscle. Yes, Julia.
There's another suggestion here of, apparently, just after the gold rush, a lot of disgruntled miners left California and went to Australia, and there was a big gold rush, quote unquote, in Australia at the time, and that was part of all this. Yeah.
So there's just more books to be written, or more things I need to know. I mean, I'm like learning about prostitutes for the first time. So that's what's so rich about this texture and history. I mean, maybe you'd have, you know, other people up here that could call out every one of these stories, but it's streets and alleys that are named after, you know, madams and whatnot. Yeah. So yeah, we have. So anyway, sorry.
So you swim out of the North End Rowing Club.
South End.
So no wonder I get lost trying to get there. Okay, so it's a South End Rowing Club. Yeah. Talk a little bit about the title for your book and, you know, swimming in cold water in San Francisco Bay. What kind of interesting people do you meet who dive in the water and swim around out here?
Well, that's part of that whole eccentric and misfit, you know, kind of element. So I joined, my first swim was with a fireman, a good friend and family member, and we'd been at a Christmas party together and said, you know, hey, you know, I said, what do you do for exercise? He asked me, what do I do for exercise? And I said, well, I swim in a pool. And he says, well, you got to come down to the club and try this out. So I go out the first time. And I swam growing up because my parents, it was kind of compulsory swimming. And I go out, and I thought my chest was going to collapse. And he just said, no, you'll get used to this. And so, of course, you know, 30-something years later, 20-something years later, the wonderful thing about the club is that there's this esprit de corps that you go out and you try things. We have people that are not strong athletes, and they have mentally, they're so tough, they do these swims that, I mean, they don't swim very fast at all. So it's pretty remarkable because the cold waters challenge you. It probably takes 20% of your energy away from you in terms of overcoming some of these long swims. So I take my hat off to so many people at that club, and I continue to hear great stories in the sauna that, like, I didn't know that. So we have, we have a really, really wonderful community, and it's all volunteer. No one's paid. And we do swims every day, every week, every month, and they're doing crazier swims than you'd ever imagine. I mean, my longest swim was from Point Bonita, and, you know, you have a one-to-one ratio with a kayaker when you're doing those swims, and everybody wants you to succeed. You know, it's just, it's that kind of feeling that when you push yourself and you're trying to do something bigger than what you thought was possible, there's people there for you. So I love that.
Wonderful. So thank you for joining the Wednesday Yachting Luncheon. Our speaker today is Lee Bruno, a journalist, science writer, and now novelist with a great, fun book about the early days of San Francisco. And for those of you celebrating Thanksgiving, I want to wish you a happy Thanksgiving. Lee, it's been fun spending time with you. And with that, our luncheon is adjourned.
Good going.
Great. How fun. How fun.